You're listening to Get to Know World of Warships, a podcast hosted by Boggzy and Synpax, produced by TNG The New Guys.
What's going on, Boggzy?
Hello, Synpax. Hello, hello.
A little bit of news in the World of Warship community contributor department. I don't know if you saw this, but Flamu just got his steel plate, I think, that YouTube sends out for crossing 100,000 subscribers.
Really? 100,000 subscribers on YouTube?
That's... on YouTube.
Wow.
You can't say he hasn't earned it. He's...
Do you think if I got 100,000 subscribers on YouTube that someone would finally be my friend?
Well, that's what I'm wondering. No, probably not, but you would get the plate in the mail.
Well, that's something, isn't it? That's almost as good as a friend.
Now, some of our listeners, you know, we started off as a podcast using the common podcast syndication tools, and we're pretty much on everywhere you could ever find podcasts. You know, Spotify, iTunes Store, the Google Podcast, you know, all of them. We're on all of them. Breaker, you mentioned, you name it. But we recently have started putting our podcast on YouTube because I know that a lot of our listeners kind of they prefer that format. It's where all their other, you know, subscriptions are, to other channels they follow, including Flamu. And I'm kind of curious to see how many subscribers we have. So, because I'm wondering how far off we are from getting one of those plaques from YouTube. Any idea?
I'd rather still have a friend.
I can't, you know, I've got that, I've got it open up in front of me, 23 subscribers.
23 subscribers?
Yeah, we're kind of a ways off.
How many of those are not Synpax? Or not Synpax's brother?
I don't listen to the podcast, so I don't, probably not. But do you think they're going to send us something for crossing 20?
I think so. I think they're going to send us offers to, I think they're going to send us targeted advertisements. I think that's what they're going to send us.
Yeah.
Oh, well, goodness.
Anyway, just to our listeners, by all means, please, if you're a YouTube a connoisseur, please subscribe to our channel and see you. Because I believe, if Flamu can get 200,000, why can't we?
Yeah, he's a potato, right? He's the king of potatoes.
Well, I'm not criticizing him, but I mean, he's good at what he does. I think we're good at what we do.
I think you're good at what we do, for sure. Definitely.
It's a team sport, bro. So what we made a little bit of news on our last podcast regarding anti-submarine warfare for heavy cruisers and battleships. And as our previous guest, I can't remember his name. He seemed, whoever it was.
It had something to do with subs, though, right?
Yeah. Anyway, I know the dev blog came out. Why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, well, as we were talking about about subs, there has been a new dev blog released talking about submarines and what they've learned from their testing phase that most of us were probably a part of. So I would say the major parts of it address the issue that Suboctavian actually shared with us, which was they did have a plan for heavy cruisers and battleships to be able to actually interact with submarines. It just was not ready at the time of the public test. So that is now part of submarines, where I guess heavy cruisers and battleships can essentially, with a infinite charge consumable, basically, call a fighter down from somewhere, from the heavens, I suppose, to patrol an area and drop depth charges on anything it spots, or anything that is spotted.
Does that fighter do any other work? Do you think it could spot surface ships if...
I don't know, but I have a feeling that that might be the case. I privately am hoping that is not the case. I'm hoping that the little person inside that plane will be, lore-wise, will be so busy looking for periscopes that he will be too busy to notice the battleship or aircraft carrier sitting in front of him.
Right, because you can choose where you deploy this anti-sub aircraft, and let's say you know you're outside of... you can drop it at 3 to 5 kilometers away, right? So if there's something you need to spot on the other side of an island, can you call this fighter in, and is it going to provide additional spotting? And I guess that's going to be a question on a lot of people's minds, but I guess there's going to be some relief, because it's not just the battleships that get this, but also you have cruisers that don't have the depth charges, which is, if this is if this fighter has multiple uses, then and can this fighter be shot down by CV's fighters?
That's a good question as well. I would assume that the fighter can be shot down by anything, probably. I would, again, this is all assumption.
Right.
I am,
so if it can be, but then if it can be shot down by, let's say you've got a, your team has a sub in an area and somebody wants to deploy one of these fighters to go try to take care of it, can your CV protect that submarine? And if that happens, then what that also means is that you can deploy this anti-sub fighter to aggro a fighter zone. Ooh. That a CV might have. So if the CV is trying to protect your destroyer, you can deploy this thing to aggro the fighter that's defending the destroyer, so then your CV can come in and strike. A lot of questions. A lot of questions that need to be answered.
Would you like me to text Sub Octavian? I have his phone number here. I'll be happy to call him. I think it's, what, 1 in the morning in Russia?
I'm sure he'd appreciate that. We need answers.
Yeah. So there's that. Obviously, there's the point defense fighter is what I'm going to call it. For the heavy cruisers and battleships, but also those ships before, they also get the ability, they get hydrophones, I guess, so they are able to ping destroyers, or sorry, ping submarines when they are themselves pinged. I think if I recall correctly, that's how it works. So there's that, meaning they're not completely blind. There's also a change, the other major change I would say is that the actual way that a submarine locks onto you with its own sonar ping has also been changed. It no longer needs to hit a ping on the bow and the stern in order to gain a lock on a target. All it needs to do is just actually hit the ship with the sonar ping. That will gain, that will give the torpedoes a little bit of a tracking behavior. And if they hit the same place on the ship that they already hit, it will cause it to ignore torpedo protection. I think I also caught here that where you ping it, where you ping the ship, is where mm-hmm. the torpedoes will attempt to go. Meaning you can actually, I suppose there is a little bit of aiming now to be said for it. So,
right. So there's a higher probability, I think, of conventional torpedoes of flooding on the bow and stern. However, I guess if you land the second ping, it avoids the ship's torpedo protection where, and so it does full citadel damage. So I guess there's some small choices, although the question remains, how easy is it to land a ping on a specific part of the ship, and how you can, you know, utilize that. And that basically keeps increasing the skill ceiling a little bit if you can be very selective about, say, ship's damicon is down, you want to maximize the chance of a flood, or whether you want to maximize the chance of a full citadel damage torpedo.
There's
a lot in that dev blog. We'll link it down below in the podcast description. I guess we also have another big announcement today, which has just been announced as we started recording this podcast. The new dates for the King of the Seas tournament have been announced. What are those dates, Boggzy?
It's going to be September 13th to September 27th. So 9/13 through 9/27 will be the initial tournament. And the international tournament between the winners will take place, I believe, in the beginning of October. I actually didn't write that date down. But so middle of September. Now, I'm curious, Synpax, when does Clan Battles end?
The 30th of August. So what this probably means is that for the more serious clans, we're going to start organizing for it, I guess, immediately. I personally kind of wish we had a little bit more of a break, but I kind of understand that COTS is on its own treadmill. It can only really exist in the clan battle off season. So they've got a small window to work with themselves. And I know that obviously because the King of the Seas is a sponsor tournament by Wargaming, there's coordination, so it's on the calendar. And, it's just time to get ready for King of the Seas again. I expect at least our clan and a couple others are probably going to have a at least one team with a bye. I expect our clan will probably run two teams as well. Quite a few other clans we rub shoulders with. So I'm looking forward to it and seeing what we're able to make of it.
The format, I think it should be noted, the format will again be, oh gosh, I'm forgetting whether it's, I think it's 9v9 with two battleships allowed per side and no CVs. So yep. That's the way it's going to look for now.
Yep, and permanent predetermined bands are going to be Smolensk, Slava, Puerto Rico, and probably some other ships. And there's also going to be a two-ship ban per team per map. So that does add some complexity. However, I think that in the past, the two-ship ban was very effective for limiting access to very specific things. One specific thing in particular was 12-kilometer radar and Stalingrad. But when you can build a strategy around the lack of 12-kilometer radar, that has implications, real strategic implications about what you can and can't do. So it opens up a lot of possibilities. And I think that was the anchor in some ways of a TNG strategy last King of the Seas, is basically we're building a strategy around being able to kick 12-kilometer radar out of the game. However, now there are four tier 10 ships. The Stalingrad and the Moskva, both premiums, and the two new tier 10 Soviet ships that are also 12-kilometer radar. So you cannot take it off the board, although I believe the duration of the new 12-kilometer radars on those new tech tree ships is a little bit shorter than, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it's a little bit shorter, at least for the light Russian cruiser, correct?
I believe, yep. 15? I know it is 15 on the Talon and the Riga, but I don't know if it shares that with the Nevsky. I think I got it, and I played one game, and I went, I never want to trust this again. So,
really?
I don't know. I don't know.
Okay. Well, more ships. So, the fundamental issue is that the more ships get added to the game, and there are constantly new ships being added to the game, new lines, new tiers and premiums, the less impact a two-ship ban will have. And inevitably, it'll have less ban because the mechanics of, say, 12K radar can be accessed through other ships. You can't take that off the map. And the other factor is that there are whatever else you wanted to ban, inevitably new ship lines have one of two things going for them to make them a little bit different. Either they have some radical new gimmick, like Venezia, okay? Radical new gimmick. Or they exist as similar to an existing ship, but just a little bit different, or between two other ships, in terms of what they can do. It's like, it's almost like a hybrid, between like Montana and Yamato. It's like something between the two of them, right? So if you wanted to ban, Montana, for whatever reason, well, okay, but there's a very near, a similar replacement to it.
Right.
So increasingly that'll be the case, and especially with the Tier 10, one of the ships that people commonly wanted to ban less, King of the Seas, didn't have 12K radar, was the Club Air. Well, now there's another, like, not quite a Club Air, but a similar, the Marceau, which is pretty similar. Anyway, right. We'll probably talk a lot more about King of the Seas in the coming weeks, now that we have the dates established. We've got a pretty good episode. Speaking of tournaments, we're going to talk to somebody who's running a very different kind of tournament. We've spoken to them before. The Warship Masters Invitational. So we'll have a discussion with them about the progress of that tournament, and then we will get back to our roots and talk to a leader of the Storm Clan. So, you excited, Boggzy?
I'm very excited. I'm also very tired. I'm really excited to ask the leader of the Storm Clan what he's going to do when his clan is in Typhoon. Is he going to change the name?
Yeah.
What about Hurricane?
That's problem. That's
topical humor, right?
If you name your clan, the thing is, though, if you name your clan the Typhoon Clan, you boom. And that raises the stakes. Yeah, that raises the stakes. So.
All right, moving right along. We are joined right now by Amatsukaze, who's going to talk with us a little bit, about Gaishu's clan Yikes's Warships Masters Invitational. So please welcome Amatsukaze. Hello.
Hello, hello. Happy to be here.
I'm really glad you're able to join us to talk. So you just finished the second run of Warship Masters Invitational. Initial one was North American clans. You just did the EU clan one. Tell us about we talked about the tournament with Gaishu initially. It's very exciting. Some some things that make it kind of special and unique. But tell us about how the European tournament went and who prevailed there.
So Europe went great, even though we had a couple clans or a clan who said at the last minute, you know, hey, it just doesn't work out for our scheduling and all that. So, you know, despite all that, we managed to get another clan in on time. I believe Rain from EU won the whole thing there. And, you know, like logistically as a tournament, we thought it went great. We introduced a couple new things, played with the point values around. And, you know, as a whole, the whole thing went pretty smooth.
Now, to set up this for our listeners who may not be aware, the way this tournament works, which is unique and special, and I really like this, is that you have a finite number of points, and based on basically your organization, which is sort of known to North American as Gaishu's Clan, which is a name that changes constantly, but that's sort of the group that runs this, let's say the WMI organization, they rate each tier 10 ship by a number of points. And then you can spend those points, you know, your bank of points on these ships. So some ships are more expensive. So in theory, you could have three battleships, but that wouldn't really leave you a lot of points left for other ships. Or you can, you know, build your lineup however you want. I think there's a maximum of 9 or 10 ships. What is it, Alma?
It was 99.
9. So the maximum of ships you can have is 9, but you can have less. So you go, we could maybe afford 3 battleships. Now let me ask you this question. How many points does a CV cost?
You know, we put up the idea. We were thinking for a 100-point system, maybe about 500 as a starting base. But, you know, at the end of the day, we decided to not include them, unfortunately.
I mean, it would be pretty funny to see one team just bring a single, for 100 points, just bring a single CV and watch two battleships just dog stomp it.
We did actually, we cut like for a brief flash, you know, in our drunk 3 a.m. balancing session, we considered it for a moment, then we decided, you know, on principle, we just didn't want to see them in the tournament at all, even as a joke, so.
I think that, I understand that, you know, you're the WMI, the organization, does have an ideological point of view that they don't like seeing CVs in competitive because it's a different game. There's no doubt it's a different game with CVs.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
For the version of the game without it. Completely understandable. And I really respect, it takes a lot of work. How big was the prize pool for European WMI?
It was the same prize pool for our NA. It was $500 USD cash for first place.
Wow.
And then a whole big pile of doubloons for second and third. So,
and to be clear though, this is out of pockets of donors. There's currently no Wargaming sponsorship with this tournament.
Right. We, and not even just donors, the organizers ourselves, we put up the entire cash pool for both tournaments as of now.
Wow. That's pretty impressive.
And organizers and a couple donors from very, very close associates. But
have you considered approaching Wargaming to get official sponsorship for this tournament?
We have. We've been in talks with them for both future regionals and, as a spoiler alert, we're looking to host an internationals.
Yep.
Which we would need press accounts for. We have been in talks with them discussing, you know, press accounts, prize pools, sponsorships, that kind of thing. So,
well, we
look forward to maybe that.
We wish you good luck for that. So is there a schedule for the next WMI?
We have a tentative date we have in mind that we pitched to Wargaming of, hey, if we set it around this date, you know, would things like press accounts and sponsorship be in the works? I believe that date is the 21st of September. Somewhere around there is when we're looking to hopefully do the internationals, but, you know, Wargame is a bureaucracy, moves at their own pace, so to speak. So.
Oh, that's understandable. That's understandable. We did just, in our conversation with Sub, we talked about what his vision is for sponsoring tournaments. And that's one area where I wish we had talked to him a little bit more and kind of gotten his idea of how he wants that process to work. But they invest heavily in King of the Seas. New King of the Seas has just been announced.
Mm-hmm.
It would be nice. I would love to see this tournament because it's so different. And you know, there's another difference here. It's truly an invitational. How does that work?
So when we were deciding on how we'd like to, you know, what teams we would like to see participate, We didn't feel that it would be topical and relevant to invite clans from clan battle seasons that have carriers in them, simply because a lot of teams that, you know, historically have been very strong in clan battles and competitive in general, they're just simply not playing these seasons. So for now, we're basing it on previous seasons of clan battles that did not include carriers. If Wargaming going forward decides that all clan battles are going to have carriers, we're going to have to look into alternative methods for seeding, so to speak. But for now, we just looked at previous seasons where, you know, we saw strong teams that enjoyed non-carrier gameplay and reached out to them. And for the most part, they turned up.
So you, between the first and second, I want to get in the weeds a little bit on kind of the one of the most interesting things to me about this tournament is the point value of different ships. Now, TNG participated in the first WMI. We're very honored to be able to participate and to get the invitation. Did you change point values for the cost of ships between the first and second?
Yeah, we listened to feedback from some of the teams and some of the team captains, especially from the NA Invitational, where, you know, a lot of teams, they felt that they weren't bringing battleships simply because they were too expensive in our system. And we also compiled data from play rates and pick rates of ships where, you know, did one or two ships, despite their cost, stand out, you know, far and above the rest? And there were a couple outliers there, namely the Venezia. But yeah, we did adjust the points a little bit in between NA and EU. And more or less, as soon as we decided on those point shifts, we posted them to the EU teams so that they would have plenty of time to adjust and refine their strategies around these new point values. So,
do you expect to make any more adjustments to the point values between the second and third tournaments?
We're looking into it, and we're also looking into whether we can include newer ships like the Petropavlovsk and Nevsky, because maybe we're thinking by the time internationals can roll around, we might have enough data on, you know, where they would actually fit inside our point system.
Right.
But for the moment, we're pretty happy for the most part with where the points are, but we might tweak a couple, you know, one or two points up or down at most.
Yeah, I see the points, and it looks a little bit different than I recall, but what do you think was the biggest point swing you made between the first and second? And, which one do you just feel like you, that, you know, hey, we really should have adjusted this better. We're going to make it better for the second one. Which one ship do you think was the most noteworthy that got a point change?
I would have to, I mean, for a ship that is such a cornerstone of competitive, we moved Stalingrad to, I believe it was 19.
It's 20 points for EU. What was it before that?
I believe it was either 18 or 19.
Yeah, it is a strong ship. It's a quasi, it's not quite a battleship, but it can punish, it can set up crossfires in a way similar to what a battleship can. In some ways better, because in many ways it's more accurate, shell velocity, etc.
It does a lot of things no other cruiser can, and a lot of things that not even a battleship can actually do.
Yeah, and the next term obviously has some complications because you've got quite a few new ships. Now, King of the Seas is banning Smolensk, just outright banning it. I think part of it may be accessibility, but, and it's one of those ships that we see often complained about as being very OP, super strong, but it's a mere 16 points, which in your scale is below Venezia, Worcester, Moskva, Salem. Why did you decide to take a ship that so many consider to be OP and make it relatively inexpensive?
The thing about Smolensk in particular is that it really scales with how, it scales in an inverse relationship with how intelligent your opponent is.
Mm-hmm. So that's why it does so well in randoms, eh?
That's where you get 80% Smolensk in randoms, and then you take that same Smolensk and throw him into clan battles, and he's the first one dead.
We pretty much saw no Smolensk in clan battles, period.
Even then, outside of the first week, like, it was after really a couple of days when people realized, hey, the ship is, you know, it's a DPM monster, but it, in terms of like map control and helping control vision, like it doesn't bring almost anything to the table unless you run into it.
Yeah. And then just some other remark, you know, I still scratch my head that you've put Colbert ahead of Zhao, Minotaur, HIV, Hindenburg, Goliath, Yoshino? What? Is there somebody in WMI that just has a hard on for the Colbert?
I believe the reasoning for putting Colbert so high was mostly due to the rarity and the difficulty of acquiring it.
That's not how the point should be done, because Puerto Rico, well, yeah, I see Puerto Rico's at 17, but it seems like the point should be, you know, how much can it contribute to the battle rather than how hard it is to get, right?
Right. And it is a hardship to get, but when we're balancing points, we run through theoretical comps on our end where, mm-hmm. okay, if we put so-and-so ship at X points, can you run it with X setup and have this be a viable setup? And right. we actually came up with a good number of what we thought were pretty decent Colbert setups.
Okay.
That worked at like a 17 point value, but then if you start dropping into like say 16 or 15, you start getting some massive advantages in some of your other ship picks, like upgrading destroyers to things like Darings and whatnot.
Yeah. It sounds like you guys, I mean, it's almost like the kind of level of attention to detail and thoughtfulness that you expect the developer themselves to have is what you guys are bringing this in. I mean, I don't mean to, this is an insult to Wargaming, but I think that the team of players you have in WMI are probably light years ahead of any, you know, of what any company has internally in terms of understanding the game and being able to play it, at least collectively, or at least even, no better than that. Let me ask you this previous, Boggzy's laughing because, and Boggzy's also forgetting that sometimes we record these things out of order. Because people are about to hear the segment after this, which we recorded before this, that we made a big deal about the fact that I have this verbal crutch of saying, let me ask you a question.
On his own podcast.
Oh, no.
Right. But he's right.
Like
he's right. There's other little verbal tics I've had when somebody calls me. I'm super, I don't want to repeat it. Oh, it's so hard. Tell me about the about the composition that Rain used to win the tournament in Europe.
So I believe Rain, for at least two of their matches, the two that stuck out to me were they brought double battleships. This was something that moving from NA to EU, we were hoping to see a lot more of, because I think people have gotten kind of complacent on double battleship crossfires and just how much map presence even a single battleship brings to a flank. Rain was one of the very few teams to actually use double battleship effectively. I believe they took Borgones in one of them, especially on Tears of the Desert.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I believe it was the third or fourth game, right?
It's a big map, fast battleship.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Sounds like could. And what's interesting about the Borgone, it is the least expensive of the battleship options.
Mm-hmm. Partially due to the gun caliber, mm-hmm. and the terrible health pool and the terrible armor scheme. It's a really, really big Henry.
Yeah.
Is really what the Borg is.
Right. But that's a good way to play it, too.
Exactly. But what Rain did that we thought was great, instead of your traditional, you know, one battleship kind of middle-ish, one battleship on a flank creating crossfires, they shoved both Borgones straight up the island chain, straight into the enemy home cap. And that was the kind of strategy and the kind of thinking that we love to see, because with the point system and with the map setups, you can't really just have like a one comp kills all maps.
Right.
And so when we loaded in and saw the double Borg, you know, we were hoping, and they didn't disappoint, but we were hoping that they had a very specific plan in mind for those double Borgs. And I mean, they did it and they executed that perfectly.
Did the Borgs, were they primarily flying AP or HE, and what was the rest of their composition, if you recall?
I mean, they were shooting a pretty good mix of both. They were punishing cruisers for turnouts and for bad angling there, but they did shoot quite a bit of HE, which you have to do in a Borg.
Yep.
I believe their other flank, I believe it was a destroyer, and I don't think it was a Zhao. It was a destroyer and some other kiting cruiser.
Yeah, actually, I have it. We're going to have a link to the WMI Discord in the clan battle description, in the podcast description. I do see it. Yeah, they brought a couple Borgones, a Des Moines, a Zhao. Well, this is actually game four. Let me find the tiers. Yeah, double Borgone, Des Moines, Zhao, Kava, Smallland, You
there
yawned.
It is, the kava.
Right.
I remember this kava now.
Yeah, and the enemy team did not bring any destroyer battleships at all. So, in as they say in the line of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. If the enemy doesn't have battleships, well, the Bourgeois becomes a pretty damn good battleship, right?
Yeah, yeah. In the absence of Yamato and Kremlin, suddenly Bourgeois a lot scarier.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So that seemed pretty compelling. What was the viewership on the streams, and who were your streamers?
So we figured it would be a lot better to obviously have EU streamers for the EU tournament.
Sure.
We reached out to people like Flamu, Flambass, how do you pronounce it? A
to the K. It's a reference to a song. It's a reference to a Kalashnikov rifle. So.
I might be a little young for that one then. Yikes.
Well,
I think he just called you old sometimes.
Oof. Well. Anyway, A to the K. Yes, yeah. he's a very popular streamer. I've learned a lot from his stream in my early days. So good. Well, did you get Flamin? Because that's a good get.
Oh yeah.
Oh wow. Yeah. How did you do?
Flamin's actually good friends with one of our more colorful members. He's known by Kirin Ichiban now. He was known by something else when he was a big time, a little bit more of a bigger streamer with Flamu. Famously known for being forced to rename like midstream. am I allowed to say it?
It's not, go ahead.
It's kind of. He was known as Bukake Blast, and that's. I believe he was midstream, like casting some EU tournament with Flamu, and he gets like a PM from some guy at Wargaming, and he's like, dude, you've got to rename.
You've got to change that name.
Jesus. You know, again, we're going to hop in the time machine here, but that is an excellent, a very interesting name. We'll leave it at that. But yeah, so we'll just call him BB. So you got
Kieran. He's known by Kieran now, but for most people.
Got it. So Flamu, we know two Flamus. We know the kind, gentle, passionate Flamu who is patient with new players and explaining them, you know, what the mistakes they make on the replays, and is just mm-hmm. the most generous gentleman. But we also know, you know, the other Flamu. Which one showed up to stream?
So I believe it was a pretty good mix of both where, you know, Flamu is not afraid to call out other high level players on the dumb things they do.
Right.
Which is good. You know, if you're a high level player and you do something dumb on stream for a big audience, you know, kind of got to expect to get called out there.
I feel like if it's an invitational, and then it's okay, you know, because to take a little bit of chin music from from Flolo.
You're opting into it, so to speak.
Yeah, I mean, I remember during one of our first time, it was kind of, you know, the first time your clan gets streamed on something,
mm-hmm.
it feels like a big deal, right? And you watch it afterwards, and I can't remember, one of the early King of the Seas, we have a clan member named Jelly Donut, and somebody, like, sit him from across the map or something, and the announcer said, oh, and somebody just took a big bite out of Jelly Donut.
Nice.
And I thought that's cute. So I'm glad to hear the stream went well, and I think that how well you guys have organized this, I'm very optimistic that that Wargaming sponsor, Boggzy, you got a couple questions for our friends.
Yes. Well, before I ask the question, I have to say also that it was an absolute pleasure for us to for us in TNG to make Warship's Masters Invitational history. I believe in the very first game. TNG, and I'm so sorry, I forget, I think it was PEDS or SCCC that we were facing.
SCCC.
I think it was SCCC. Yeah.
There was an absolute tie in the very first match. like, it was an actual draw, and it was, I think it's even a highlight reel in your guys, in that really cool, I want to call it like a promotional video that mm-hmm. Jake State Farm made for you guys, which was really neat.
Bless you, Jake.
Yeah, so, anyway, just I guess that's just me hyping it because I thought it was cool. But I just before we let you go, I was curious because I'm looking at the data that you guys released. I'm pretty sure this is the EU data where you guys released the number and frequency of each ship pick. And mm-hmm. I noticed that the most, this hopefully will delight some people, the most played ship was the Yu Yang.
Mm-hmm. And I believe it was, do- I believe it was that way for NA as well. Or like, if not the most one of.
Did that surprise you guys? Were you expecting people to go, oh, it's only 7 points and it has radar? Gimme, gimme, gimme.
So when we initially, especially for the NA tournament, when we initially made the Yu Yang so low, we figured, you know, it's been very out of meta for a while. The radar delay especially really hurts Yu Yang's team utility. But, you know, it does still have deep waters. It's still kind of effective, but, you know, it's really not even on the same level as like a Z locking down certain caps kind of thing. So when we put it at such a low point value, we were expecting to see a couple just as like point fillers, you know, where it's like, oh, you know, we're our team comp is basically done. I guess we take a Yu Yang and throw it somewhere on the map. What actually happened is teams were using them to fill points, but then they were using them well beyond what we expected to be effective. It turns out people haven't forgotten how to actually play the ship.
Right.
Were they bringing smoke or radar?
We saw good mixes, actually. I believe we saw more radars than smoke.
But that smoke has a special utility, you know?
It does. It lets you creep forward and you know, cross island gaps effectively and cover very quickly for your team's retreats or pushes.
Yep.
Yeah, and it is good at like a quick panic button if you really need it.
Yeah, and you don't have to think twice about it, unlike the American ones.
Yeah, you just pop it and go.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, I'm looking at the compositions of some of these teams, and it is because it's just a one day thing. I think it.
Yeah.
There's not really time for a quote unquote meta to settle, so you kind of just you get all this crazy stuff. It's like you get your one in, you get the other. Now I have one concern about your tournament, and this is kind of a concern for everything, and it did kind of impact our clan's. Ability to, because we our team that we put together for WMI, we weren't able to give it enough prep. There are a lot of folks who weren't able to make it because of scheduling issues. And if it be, you know, I want to make a much more committed effort if we do this tournament again. But one of the challenges is the calendar, because you know COTS has been announced, and clan battles. COTS kind of exists between those clan battle seasons. Do you find it difficult to find time on the calendar, because you kind of because not it's not just the day that it takes place. Serious teams need time to the scrimmage and all this stuff, right? Exactly. So what's your approach to solving the calendar problem?
So for us, we're trying to not step on anybody's toes with like scheduling with like COTS and claim battles and all that. I mean, with so much going on in warships nowadays, with everything being, you know, all the competitive scene going on, whether it's COTS or claim battles or the new Supremacy League and all that, we're trying to not really step on anyone's toes there. And we're trying to give teams as much time as we possibly can. You know, when we change the point values for EU, we try to do that, you know, in a couple of days after the NA tournament, just to give them as much time as we could. Going forward, if we're going to do this again, where we do two regionals and then an internationals, we would potentially look to do that spread out over the course of maybe the entire year. The thing with these tournaments is, especially if you're only running it, you know, once or twice a year, you know, especially for a niche game like Warships, the community changes quite a bit in those times sometimes, you know, even old vets, you know, they've got a thing they love to watch, but it only happens every 6 months, you know, they might not come watch the next one. So
right, and that's also a challenge of teams.
Yeah, because you've got players that come in and out, and
invitational means invitational. Clans that, you know, new clans emerge, others disintegrate, some get stronger, some get weaker, don't make the cut anymore. So you've mentioned that it would be based on prior invitation. Could go back to this, and then we'll wrap up, because you've been very generous with your time. So you're looking at clan battle finishings, right? But that also depends on how many slots you've got. You know, so how big do you expect this tournament to grow? Because I think the initial North American one, you had six clans.
Eight,
yeah. Is that a size that you're going to be comfortable with moving forward? Because you could do it in one day, or?
Yeah, so our goal for, like, logistically and organizationally here is to have this tournament run in one day as quickly and smoothly as possible. Mm-hmm. And with eight teams is about the most you can get in, like, a really solid day of tournament casting.
Sure.
If you take it to 12, you're probably running into the 7 to 8 hour territory, whereas with 8, we've ran about between 5 and 6, which is, that's still a good day, but that's doable.
Yeah, but it does require permission from the wife and scheduling and all that kind
of
stuff.
It is still, you're more or less dedicating your, you know, a good portion of your day to the tournament, but 8 is about where we've settled and we're pretty happy with where it's at.
Right.
We've considered doing things like a best of one show match kind of deal, where there's some kind of crazy rule, or, you know, some other interesting circumstance to, like, kick off the tournament kind of thing.
Sure. Well, I think the risk of that is that you end up, if it's too spur of the moment or too, I guess, cheeky in its format, you don't quite get those really intense, thoughtful games that I think you got with Raynor, the kind of game that would end in a
literal 999 draw kind of thing.
Yep, exactly. We are really big fans of independent tournaments and the diversity, the variety. Not only is it without CVs, but it's also got this really interesting, well thought out point system. This podcast is, it's small right now, and I don't know if it's going to get much bigger, but we do want to use some of the revenue that our listeners have helped us just generate, primarily because of the ads we run through Anchor, to help out. So we'd like to, for the next tournament that you guys sponsor that involves at least North American clans, we'd like to add $20 to the prize pool on behalf of the new guys.
Oh, thank you. That's very generous of you. And we've, if you've seen the EU version, and I'm sure some of you have, the clan advertisements that we kind of poked clans about as a fun idea to kind of kill time between matches, those seem to have been very successful. And we're looking at maybe using them or something similar to help crowdfund the tournament, just in general.
Interesting.
Simply because, you know, we're happy to get the tournament off the ground, you know, on our own back, so to speak. But going forward, you know, putting up a nearly $2,000 prize pool over the course of a year just from a small group like ours isn't really too financially viable.
Sure.
So,
yeah. Well, I mean, you might also talk to some of the streamers that have cast cast the tournament already or might in the future, and ask them if they, you know, how they would feel about basically holding a little fundraiser on their own stream about it too.
Yeah, and I mean, the thing is, you're creating content for these streamers, so maybe it's, you should ask them to kick in a little bit as well, you know, for broadcast rights, which is how it works in the professional sports industry. Nobody gets to carry the Super Bowl for free. Fox pays a prepay. Now, obviously, how you guys work that out, there's all kinds of different ways to approach it, but and getting Wargaming sponsorship for the term, I think, would also be tremendously helpful. But we're glad to help out a little bit when we can, because when we see this, we want to encourage it. So with that, I think we'll end the segment unless you've got anything else, Boggzy.
That's it for me.
Yeah, so down below in the podcast description, along with several other links, you will see a link to the Warship Masters Invitational Discord. And with that, I really want to thank our guest for his generosity in coming on our program and explaining all of this to us, because we're very excited.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It was good to kind of clear the air with some of our thoughts, because Lord knows, really know what's going on in our own times.
Thank you very much for sticking with us through that quick break. We are now going to be talking with King with Clan Storm in the form of Newfie Boy. Hello, sir. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. And yourself?
I'm doing quite well. I am happy to be here and be alive on this wonderful, wonderful day in World of Warships. So let's get right to it. Let's talk about Clan Storm. Who the hell are you? Where did you guys come from?
Well, Clan Storm, or Storm Clan, as we like to be called, We're quite a really old clan. We've come from many different games, but primarily we started off as a World of Tanks clan back in, alpha days for World of Tanks. Wow. Yeah, really, really quite old. So most of us, I would say, most of us that were around during that time, there's probably only about three or four of us now left from the core group. But we consider ourselves to be an old clan of about 10 years, going on 10 years. So the guys that I've known in there that have kind of transitioned with us from, you know, server to server, from TeamSpeak to Ventrilo to Discord and all around the verse have been with us for probably going on about 8 years, 8 to 7 years. So yeah, we're kind of a loose group of guys. We're from all over the place. I myself am from Newfoundland, Canada. I'm living in Nova Scotia at the moment. Some of the guys are from the eastern seaboard of the States, some are from the West, some are from Australia. One guy's from Australia, some guys are from Europe. We're not picky who we recruit, as long as they get along well with us and we get along well with them. No drama, you know, it's one of our major rules. And that's kind of who we are and how we came to be.
So I got to just ask you this directly. I think there's no beating around the bush. Does the government of Canada pay you people to play World of Warships? I don't understand how there can be 100 Canadians in the entire world and somehow there are 400 playing this game at any given time.
Absolutely. Yep. We are paid in birchbark dollars. And
okay.
Yeah, birchbark dollars is how we're paid in booze. Second payment. But no, you know, I don't know why, but I've run into a lot of Canadians playing the game, a lot from the Atlantic Canadian region. I think it's because we seek each other out and we're very proud to say, yep, I'm a Canadian and I play this. So you might see a lot of other folks, you know, from Europe or from Australia or from other places around the world playing in the NA servers. They don't really promote themselves. Canadians, for some reason, are very quick to say, yep, that's me. I'm Canadian. I'm from so-and-so. Hey, do you know so-and-so from so-and-so? And it's just the way we are. Yeah.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, Canadians are perfect, so never change.
Thank you.
My pleasure. So the fact that you guys came all the way from World of Tanks, I mean, does that mean that you started playing Warships with as a clan? Like, did you all say, we're going to go to Warships, we're going to start Clan Storm or Storm Clan? Or did you sort of find each other in the game afterwards? Where, hey, I play it.
Yes, no, maybe so. A little bit of all. So the core group of guys that left World of Tanks, we just got tired with the way World of Tanks was working. Know physics and engines changing and rules and yada yada. So we all sure. We all kind of moved to War Thunder first, and we picked up a bunch of new members in War Thunder. And again, one of our core members had gotten into the early alpha of this World of Battleships. Right? What is World of Battleships? Oh wait, no, sorry, it changed its name. It was only World of Battleships for a hot minute. So now we're World of Warships. Great. Okay, so he managed to entice some of us to sign up and try and get into this new thing. Because, we hate World of Warships. You know, we hate World of Tanks. We don't want to go with another game. We don't want another one of their games. But that's fine. We all tried it anyway. A lot of us got into the early alpha, and we just kind of dragged our guys kicking and screaming from World of Tanks and from War Thunder over. And then as we got into World of Warships, we started picking up many, many more people along the way. You know, some folks have stayed with us through the entire time. Other folks have kind of drifted away and moved on to their own. But that's kind of how we made it here, I guess.
So I've got a few questions for you. You guys are named a Storm Clan, and you, performance-wise, you have consistently been a Storm 1 and Typhoon 3 clan. That's a nice accomplishment. Do you consider yourselves to be a quote-unquote competitive clan, or are you casual, or do you straddle the line?
Oh no, we are certainly casual. We have some guys in the clan that are very, very competitive, and they want to, but as a clan leader, probably about don't know how many Clan Wars now. This was back maybe
10,
three or four. Well, yeah, we're in 10 now, but maybe about three or four back. I made an announcement to our entire group of guys being like, okay, we are a casual clan. If you're looking for ultra competitive, go somewhere else. We're a bunch of close knit friends first and foremost, clan members second, and you know, players last. So we're here for the fun of it. When it's no longer fun, it's no longer entertaining for us, nobody's gonna want to continue to play anymore. So keep it civil, let's have fun, let's do some stupid stuff, and you know, let's go blow up some ships. And we've maintained that kind of that kind of feeling throughout our clan's tenure in all of our various games that we play, is keep it fun, you know, do stupid things, and try and pull out a little bit of fun out of every situation we happen to be in, regardless of what it is. So, you know, we get dropped into a terrible match where we're all tier 8s and a tier 10. Okay, boys, let's go do something dumb. We have a clan motto. Our clan motto is up the middle always. Can you guess where we're going up the middle?
Oh, always. Boy. Two brothers.
Absolutely. Two brothers. It is a requirement of our clan. If you join our clan, if two brothers lands, you have to go up the middle regardless of what side you're on. Doesn't matter. Even better if there's a bunch of Storm Clan on one side and a bunch of Storm Clan on the other side. We'll nuke each other in the middle. It's great.
What about aircraft carriers?
They have to go too.
Oh, man.
So, yep. Let me ask. Well, I've got to get away from it, because Boggzy gets on me about saying, well, you've got one of these things, these crutches in your verbiage. Let me ask you a question. I've got a question for you. I'm just going to ask the question stuff.
Yeah, right.
Let me ask you a question.
That should be the name of the new podcast. Let me ask you a question with Synpax and Boggzy. In that one, my name has to go first because of the title.
I agree.
It's so hard not
did
to do
your
it.
Question?
No, I didn't. I did. I'm just trying to avoid using that. It's like when people start saying or so or my question for you.
This is going in the title. This is the episode like where Boggzy made Synpax self-conscious.
Ouch. As a clan leader, now you say you're a casual clan, and as a casual clan leader, I suspect that it's a little bit easier to be a leader of a casual clan than maybe a competitive one. Nonetheless, you probably have had difficult situations. Why don't you tell us about one of the difficult situations you had to deal with as a clan leader and how you handled it?
Oh, yeah. I hope nobody's listening to this as far as my clan is concerned.
Nobody's listening at all. Just us and our moms. Yep.
Just us and our kids in the background, I guess.
They have headphones in. They came prepared.
Actually, mine does. She's sitting behind me watching some vampire kids show. So good for her. So let's see some difficult situations. At one point during the clan's lifespan, some of the clan members wanted to become more competitive and some of us wanted to stay less competitive. Now, we've got what we call the core clan members, or our executive group. Our executive group is built up of the guys, not necessarily who play World of Warships the most, but who are the most senior in the clan and who've been around the longest and kind of help guide the clan's direction as far as keeping everything civil, keeping everything fun, kind of happy and lighthearted. So when one of the core members might say, hey, you know, let's consider going serious for a little while, then the other core members kind of have to look at it and go, okay, let's take this and you know, beat it out and chat about it a bit and see where it goes. So all it took was that one core member to say, hey, we're going serious, maybe going serious, when a couple of other guys who are the real true diehards in the clan just kind of jumped on it and created a little bit of animosity within the clan. You know, some people aren't taking it seriously enough. During clan wars, we're going to run our alpha group or we're going to run our best guys. All the while, we've got, you know, 5-6 other guys who've been sitting there twiddling their thumbs for like 2 hours waiting to battle. So as the, you know, original members, as the core or executive, whatever you want to call us, we had to jump in and basically say, look, yeah, it's great. We're running some great battles. And we're winning a lot of stuff here as our, you know, some of our better sailors. But it's not fair to the other guys who are sitting here and have been sitting here for 2-3 hours. So, you know, here I am injecting kind of, I don't want to say I'm taking away their fun or taking away their ability to win, but we want to make sure everyone was included. Now, saying that, we may have included people to the detriment of our ranking within the Clan Wars seasons. But you know what? That's fine. And as far as a clan leader goes, I'm perfectly okay with that. Taking a little bit of a shot to the, you know, a shot to make sure everyone's involved and everyone's having a good time. I think that's part of it. Maybe it's the Canadian in me making sure everyone's okay. But yeah, thanks. But it's kind of the way we look at it, and it's been one of the things we've run our clan by for as long as I can remember.
When that conflict came up, though, you got 2 ratings. Do you perhaps rotate people in? I mean, how do you solve that? Because we bring a lot of clans on here of different skill levels, because honestly, that's not the point of this podcast. We're not interested in only talking the best of the best, the purple of the purple. We talk to everybody. We've been doing our best to actually get the clan that finished in last place on, just because it just seems fascinating, right?
Sure.
Or clans that play 500 battles a season and they're in Gale. That's kind of interesting on its own. But you guys are actually a decent clan. And I can say some folks in, I say, more elite clans may not appreciate that, but coming from somebody who's been in a clan, who's gone through all the phases, starting off first season in Gale and then just barely making Storm and just gradually, you actually are, and you know what, if we run into you in clan battles, we got to pay attention. We got to pay attention. It's not going to be a walk. And I appreciate that you built a clan that can do that. But, you know, having folks that are just old friends of yours that are in the clan who maybe they have a very casual approach to the game. Their skills don't quite, there's a skill stratification in your clan that are on the lower end of it. Do you maybe decide, maybe everybody gets to play, maybe everybody rotates, but the decision is, well, what rating you're going to play on when you've got, you know, this lineup versus the other.
That's right. Yep. So we've got your alpha and your beta. Thank you, Wargaming, for your alpha and your beta groups. So when we've got, say, our more skilled individuals in playing the game, we will, you know, maybe move over to alpha, or maybe move over to beta, see whichever group is doing better, right, at the time, and we'll play our, you know, our more skilled guys over there, because we may not always get enough people to fill out both ranks, right, alpha and beta. At the same time.
Or like to be able to run 2 concurrent divisions, is what you're saying.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. Two divisions, alpha, yeah, you got, alphas and the betas.
You got your people on the bench twiddling thumbs, and that can become a problem if you, so, but it seems like exactly. The ratings serve as your way of kind of having the cake and eating it too.
We try that. We try that as much as we possibly can to eat our, you know, have our cake and eat it too, by doing exactly that, making sure we're switching up our rating or switching up our alpha and beta depending on who's round and who's playing. I'm pretty happy to say we have probably, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say with it, we have one of the top 10 CV players anywhere.
Wow.
In World of Warships.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah. He used to go by the tag Poro or Porosis. I think he goes by, Jesus, let me look over at his tag now. It's I Can't Hear You. HIRYU. So if you see him,
it's hear you like the ship, right?
Exactly. Yep. I can't hear you. Yeah. Funny. Haha. Right. So he's going to hear this and be like, "New Fae."
Right.
But anyway, he is absolutely one of the best CV players I've come across anywhere, and most people will ever come across. He comes. I'd say his average damage in CVs is 150,000.
Wow.
Just kind of. You know, not counting the early days and some of the crappy ships, but, you know, take his decent run of CVs, and he's very, very good, very well up there. So when we get him on and we get to play CV matches, he really pulls it for the clan. And not to mention, we've got a couple of guys like that, a couple of guys on battleships who are exceptionally well, some other guys in cruisers who are very, very good. We just kind of lucked out having some really skilled talent out of the pool.
I hear you.
Looking for it.
But
it just came.
You mentioned that, so Alpha Bravo rating, you rotate players.
Yeah.
Does anybody ever get their feeling hurt when, whenever I walk around sidewalks, I guess there's just something about my appearance that I hear that lock, people see their cars just check that their cars are locked. So I hear that click as I'm walking down the street. And it doesn't bother me too much, but it bothers me a little bit. Does it ever bother anybody when they jump in the div and say, oh, we're switching from Alpha to Bravo? Because maybe they're just a little bit more casual, or does everybody have a good attitude about it?
Everyone's pretty much a good attitude. If they do, they've never come to me about it. And I'm the kind of clan leader that people just kind of, they'll message just off the cuff and say, hey, I feel like I haven't been played enough this season. Or, let's do some giveaways or something to boost some clan morale, or try to get people on. Because I'm sure, just as you've spoken to other people, some folks are a little disappointed in this season's clan wars, just because of the...
Are you disappointed?
No, I love it. Not everyone agrees with me in my clan, and that's perfectly fine. We're all allowed our own opinion. I like tier 6. It is perfectly fine. I like some lower stuff. I like to get out there and play some different things. It's not always about the tier 10 battleships. It's not always about your tier 8 monster amounts of premiums. Sometimes it's some of the lower, scrappier stuff. As a fact, we have had lower participation in this season of Clan Wars than we've ever had. It is because tier 6.
Do you? That's odd, because in some ways it's a very accessible tier, but I guess some folks just don't want to play it. Is that the reason, or do you think it may just be, it's summer, or?
No, none of the above. It's summer, but it's COVID summer, so nobody's really going anywhere and doing anything. We're all kind of just mostly staying around our areas, I guess. But from talking to the clan and other folks in other clans, it's just they're just not feeling the tier 6, and as such, the numbers are down all across the board. So we've had to take some, I don't want to say drastic measures, but we've had to do some interesting kind of internal giveaways now that they're allowing us to, create some super containers from oil and give away our coal and stuff like that. We've kind of created some giveaways or challenges, I'll say, around that to try and bring back some participation, bring back our members.
Before I hand it to Boggzy, one last thing. What's your take on the addition of CVs to clan battles?
Well, our CV guy loves it.
So does ours, or all of them, yeah.
Yeah, the rest of us are like, CVs ruined it all for us. But personally, not as a clan stance, because as a clan stance, I'd say overall, we're probably 80-20. 80 don't like, 20 like. But as far as I'm concerned, as where Wargaming is taking it, I think it's fine. Time will tell if the CVs are able to be balanced out properly in a smaller, in a clan war style. We just change our tactics, basically. Like right now in tier 6, if we run into a CV, we have a tactic. If we run into a battleship, we have a different tactic. And then based on what, the enemy is doing, that determines where we go. So,
what kind of Canadian blasphemy is this? This is Shooty Pixel Boats, okay? This is Shooty Pixel Casino Boat game, and you take your ships from the beginning, you put them in one or the other direction, and you do not stop moving forward and firing until everything is sunk.
Oh, Canadians. My. Yes, of course. Pixel Shooty Boats with the big cannons and things. You have to go one direction. Everybody stays as close as possible so we can shoot each other with fire. It gets a bit more complicated than that, I guess. And we've got several people, I guess, as most clans, so you have your callers or your commanders during your clan wars. And we've been very, very lucky to have gotten some real great commanders over the years to kind of lead us. I like to say, as a clan leader, I'm definitely not the best. I'm definitely not the worst. I'm somewhere in the middle. I just happen to be a little bit of the glue that sticks the clan together. Now, they're all going to hear this, and they're going to go crazy. They're going to start laughing. I almost cursed. But they're going to laugh hard at that, because they're like, you're no glue. You're something else. I'm like, okay. But, yeah, we've had some great commanders over the years who've been able to really devise some interesting tactics. And we've gone in and done some training sessions and whatnot, you know, kind of after hours or before hours to kind of hammer out some of what we do. But again, as a casual clan, we don't really do too much of that. We kind of leave it up to the individual skills of the players, and we kind of just kind of set a bigger, you know, overall strategy. Like, you guys go there, you guys go there, don't die, do your thing, bye.
And don't die is a good, I mean, I think that's really good.
We should try that
motto. Yeah.
Don't die thing kind of works for us a little bit from time to time. I guess
it's so much more specific than just don't suck, you know. It's
don't suck, don't die. No, but in all honesty, our commanders have been real good, and they've been able to give us a bit of good guidance over the years.
Well, it's great to hear. It's glad to hear that this is not this clan battle season has not defeated you guys, as I know that it has. It has for some people where they just can't handle the tier six, so or the CVs, I suppose. But why don't we do this? Why don't we set ourselves up for a break and play sink a ship here? So, newbie, I'm going to ask you, or sorry, not newbie, Newfie, I'm going to ask you to prep yourself by preparing to sink a ship. I need you to forget for a moment that you're Canadian, that you would never sink anything, not even a fly, and prepare to remove a ship from the game. Any want, no lines, nothing like that. Just one ship. Thank you for sticking with us through that break and listening to that lovely woman give a little ad. I wonder if I could meet her someday. So we're talking with Storm Clan in the form of Newfie, and we've asked him to sink a ship. So Newfie, what's it going to be? Who's getting the axe?
You know what? I'm going to have to take out the Izumo. I don't like the Izumo. Let's get rid of that guy. Make it go my way.
That's a first, I think. Has anyone else tried to sink the Izumo Synpax?
Nope. Why? What's wrong with it? Now, there's different motivations for sinking a ship. Sometimes it's because it's so OP. Other times it's because it's under P, as we learned with the Kabarovsk recently. What's your motivation?
Right. Well, having been one of the old guys here playing this game back in early alpha and beta, and I don't know where it is right now, but whatever states it is, the Izumo was the most terrible grind ship to have to make your way through to get to the overpowered Yamato that used to be. So why would I get rid of the Izumo? For that exact reason. Is it was a painful memory climbing through that Izumo, seeing all my friends make it to the Yamato before me and one-shotting me back in the early days of World Warships, World of Battleships, whatever you want to call it. I don't think the Izumo was in World of Battleships, but anyway, I digress.
I think it's called World of CVs now, but go on.
Oh, Poro, he's going to love that. I'd get rid of the Izumo because it was just a terrible grind, and I have horrible memories grinding through the Izumo.
Are you aware, though, that the ship was got some pretty good buffs?
Oh, I know. I know.
So you're kicking it, you're banning it out of spite.
I'm banning it out of spite. Absolutely. It is gone for that one reason. But yes, I know. It is not bad anymore. I bought it for a challenge a while back, got rid of it again, but... Yeah, you know, memories hard to fade, I guess.
Okay, well, that's, you know, we've been surprised by sink a ship lately, haven't we, Boggzy?
We absolutely have, and actually, his answer right now reminds me of your answer, Synpax, because your answer was the Seattle, and the whole reason was because it just is a nightmare, and it has the worst gun traverse of any light cruiser in the entire game.
You know what?
It reminds me of yours.
You know, I actually have an idea. I'm going to test both what Fem and Sub said. What do you think about this, Doofy? I'm going to make a post on the World of Warships forum, a well-researched, well-thought-out post, explaining why I believe it is merely an oversight that the Seattle's gun traverse is as bad as it is. It was an oversight. And if they just fix it so it's something between Cleveland and Worcester, or maybe just almost as good as Cleveland or up there, that the ship, that will fix so many problems with the ship, which is, I believe, underperforming. So I'm going to make like a really lawyerly well researched with, you know, I'm gonna bring up my little white mouse and make like charts, graphs of like, this is where this traverses and this traverse. But then when you compare it, you know, and break that all out, do you think, Newfie, that if I do that, what do you think the odds are that World of Warships will fix the turret traverse on the Seattle?
I don't know about the same chances are going to fix UI bugs in the game.
Well, they've been gradually working on those. They've been, but I have hope. What do you think, Boggzy? Do you think that
I they might. I don't know. My entire understanding of how wargaming functions was a little. It was kind of like a big old open hand slap to the face when Sub said he wanted to sink the Khabarovs because he wanted to start over. Because in my mind I was going, well, that's why you're releasing the DDR-10 because
I thought that Khabarovs.
You're like, hey, this ship is terrible. I'm gonna take it out and then just release it as something to buy. And I thought, that evil genius. That's amazing. So
yeah, that
I mean,
sounds about right.
Maybe you can get him to just take the Seattle out and replace it with a better Seattle that you can buy.
Well,
who knows?
Sure, but it's a tech tree ship, and a turret traverse buff is it's microscopic. It's not even a DPM buff, which is usually what they do when they try to fix a ship. So what my thinking is. Guys, spare with me, is that if I make this post,
yep.
Now there's a chance I'm wrong. Like my reading of that ship, it's not as bad as I think it is. I don't know how to play it. There's an S word I'd use to refer to myself, but I'm super casual. That's the S word. And I'll never scrub. Let's go with that. And you know, that's the real problem here. Maybe, but if it turns out I'm right and you know, there's a mention in dev blog as, oh, by the way, you know, because they have like the little changes are way down. Or we're going to increase the turret traverse on the Seattle. After I make this post, then we can't really abide any more complaining about Wargaming not listening. Now, if they ignore it, that doesn't mean they don't listen either. It could just mean I was wrong, right? But we have to acknowledge that if I make that kind of a post and there is a change in Seattle turret traverse, that they listen, right?
I don't know how you get to argue, yeah.
If you post it and they make a change for you, I will buy you doubloons.
Oh, how many doubloons?
Well, we didn't say yet. It is a fixed number of doubloons to be announced at a later time.
I will accept that offer. And I will accept that offer, you know, because we want to believe that a company with whom we invest so much time, in many cases money, and emotion, listen, so that's going to be the little test. So perhaps this weekend I'll script together exactly why I think the Seattle's turret traverse was an oversight. It wasn't designed to be that way. It should have been. It was just an error in the database, error in the spreadsheet. And we'll see. So on that, do you have any other... I'm trying to think if I... have any other questions for our guest, but he's been so articulate, such a good advocate. Oh, we do have one segment left for him though, don't we?
Well, yes, but also I need to, Newfie, I need to talk to you about some of the names of your clanmates. because as we all know, I am not a neurotic laughing mess most of the time, but I was rendered a neurotic laughing mess before you even came on when I was looking through your clans list. And Synpax had to laugh. He had to listen to me cry laughing over some of the names of your. Maybe it's just because I'm tired or something, or that I really like puns. But I liked I Can't Hear You, spelled like the ship Hear You. I liked that one already. Mm-hmm. I liked Who Da Frack Are You? I don't know why I like that one either. Maybe because I'm a Battlestar Galactica guy. But then you've got a guy in your clan named Sir Schlong Connery.
Yes.
Sir Schlong Connery.
We thought for sure his name wasn't going to get banned and requested to be changed to something else. But nope. It's been there. Yeah.
I can't. Yeah. We've had people lose like names for the dumbest reasons, but Sir Schlong Connery hasn't gotten the ban hammer from Wargaming yet.
Nope.
Also a guy named Steel Balls. Like, what?
Yep.
Where do you come up with
what these do you make your balls out of?
Steel has been around with us, and he's not a core member, but he's been around with a Sensacor and Sakor. And he's had the same name since World of Tanks.
Whoa.
He's never changed. Never.
You know, Boggzy, the new feed here has, I think, inspired an idea for a new segment. And maybe that? It's a new way to get some of that listener participation that I'm told is so important for growing, you know, a podcast. I want to hear, like, you play games and you see a name, it just makes you laugh, or you just think it's really funny or cool. I'd like our listeners, if you've got somebody, a name you've seen in game, and it has to be a real name in game, why don't you send it to us? And we'd like to make that be like a regular segment. Maybe you're open or maybe you're a closer, Boggzy.
I think that's a great idea. I love closing with a laugh. So I mean, open with a laugh too. But I think it's a great idea to have people send us names. I think we're going to have to request a screenshot or something as well, just to confirm.
Well, if they give us a name, we can look it up and I can confirm that it's real. But like at the end of the show, if we rattle off a couple of names that. Are names of the episode or
sure. I can mm-hmm. say that like there are some names that I've only seen in battle maybe once or twice, but I will never forget them. Specifically the ones that tend to reference a citadel somehow. Like there are two that I remember. One of my sit is ready. I just I don't know why I like that one so much, and then the other one was show me your sits.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's great.
Some of them just stay, you know, the one that I think I only saw it once, but it stayed with me forever. And it may have been years ago. And maybe it's just a personal thing, but it's the wife is yelling. That's the best name I've come across personally. But folks can be so creative about it. And
I know.
No, hey, a new fee, we have to thank you because this you have inspired so much and contributed so much to this podcast. And I think I really like the segment. So I just, you know, a little business here. Listeners, send us your suggestions for, I will have to figure out a right handle for this, but interesting names, send it to thenewguyswows@gmail.com. And if it's a good one, we'll read it on the air. If this is air, can we say air?
Sure, why not?
Yeah.
That sounds fine.
Well, with that, I think, Boggzy, unless you've got anything else for our good newfie friend here, I'll take us to plugs.
I'm sorry.
Oh, we have to do the post.
Do you not feel like leaving our clan today? Every day we do this, you feel like leaving. What's different?
Maybe I'm just trying to cope with the fact that I wake up every morning with this desire to be poached. And part of it may have been because I myself have poached so much that maybe once, just once, I'd like to be the poachee.
Can I suggest poaching Sir Shlong Connery?
No, you don't want him. He's gonna hear this. He's gonna hear this, and he's gonna be like, "What?" Our resident potty mouth and our resident bad butt. I don't know how to.
Well, he fit right in with us. I don't know if you've heard about our reputation, man. But
he is an absolute acquired taste and quite unpalatable to many.
Right, okay.
What nice guy.
All right,
well,
he's a gigantic nurse, or used to be, but anyway.
Set him up. Set this up here, Boggzy.
Okay, well, all right, Newfie, here's the thing. So what you're going to do now is you're going to let Synpax here know why it is that he needs to leave the clan that he created and grew and even decided to, you know, start a podcast around. You're going to convince him why joining Storm Clan along the likes of Sir Shlong Connery, I Can't Hear You, and Who the Frack Are You? You're going to convince him why that's a good idea. Go for it.
All right. Let's see. All right, shake it off, and let's do it. Okay, so do you like the idea of playing Dursky battles 24/7? Going down into Torpedo Alley and absolutely wrecking face? If you do, join Storm Clan. Do you think you like the idea of going up the middle and two brothers every time? Join Storm Clan. Do you like the idea of more team damage than enemy damage? Join Storm Clan. We are the clan for you.
You know, Boggzy, am I alone in feeling like somebody prepared for this segment?
I
did not.
Wow, that was off the hip, huh?
That was off the hip. I did not listen to any of your podcasts leading up to this because I knew this was coming.
Why not? Why didn't you listen to our podcast?
I knew
he's like, because I don't listen to trash.
He has a point.
Come on now, boys. I wanted to be taken completely by surprise for all the segments that we have here. And so far, so good. You guys have done a pretty good number on me, I must say. when you kind of, you know, hinted that this was coming, I kind of thought in the back of my head, you know what? I'm not even going to fool with this. I'm just going to say straight up what we do and why we're fun and why half the time we get people. I kid you not, we have gotten at least 3 to 4 clan members who have all ended up being what it's now for at least 2 to 3 years because we went right down the middle in two brothers. And they're like, you know what? We like your moxie.
You know, I hate to say it, but I can't tell you the number of times I've been disappointed on two brothers when the other team does that and they prevail.
Oh, yes.
Because it's not the instant loss that it should be, but it is.
We are experts at perfecting the two brothers down the middle tactic. We hold the enemy for so long focusing on us in the middle, the two of us that happen to go or three of us that happen to go down the middle, while the rest of our team is circling around and absolutely destroying them. Well, that's usually our hope. That's if the rest of our team decides they want to listen. Because, you know, as you all know, puppy games and people and randomness, and yeah, they kind of do what they want to sometimes. But if we get a successful sync drop with enough of our guys, yeah, it's always great fun.
Well, I find that I would have to say that you're in the top five in terms of, God, we've done what is this, episode 44, Boggzy?
44, yeah.
Holy Moses. Does it feel like 44 episodes to you? Because it feels like 10 to me or less. I have no idea how we ever did 40-something episodes. Anyway.
Synpax, every time you and I talk, I feel like I'm on cloud nine. So as far as I'm aware, this is the first time we've ever done it.
Guys, you know what? Speaking to you, I feel like I'm on cloud nine. For
me, it's, come on.
Every maybe time, like the first time, eh, Boggzy?
Well, yeah, maybe it's right. My back medication I took earlier. I'm not quite sure. But,
what the hell?
either way, it feels quite good.
Back, do you wash it down with maple syrup?
Oh, come on. I'm not drinking anything but milk.
I know. That one was for our clan mate, Peter Piper. He needed it.
Oh, he's Canadian, is he?
Well, yes. I would put your
wants to be Canadian?
We haven't rooted them all out yet, but I'm on it. Don't worry.
It's like our clan is like half Canadian. I have no idea how this happened.
Really?
Yeah.
Sweet. That's great. You guys must be doing well for yourselves.
Yeah.
Is that what that means?
Yeah. Well, we're all Navy guys at heart.
They're mostly fairly, like, you know, really polite, which is good because it makes the average clan member seem more polite. So we're able to, the more extreme members on the other side get averaged out. We have a nice mean level of politeness thanks to all of our Canadians. But you're definitely in the top five in terms of the pitches. And I think that there are a lot of folks who, having heard this podcast, would probably give you some strong consideration because they're looking for good but not hyper-competitive. They don't want clan battles with screaming matches and a lot of vindictiveness or pressure. But, you know, I expect this season you guys will push your way right into Typhoon without too much effort. You're doing so pretty well this season, and it sounds like you've got some good camaraderie, good group of guys. So I compliment you on your poaching skills. I give you A-.
I guess that's good enough. Good enough.
Well, there's a curve. So, I mean, A- is pretty good on a curve, right?
Yeah, A- is pretty good on a curve.
Well, on that note, I will I'll bring us to plugs. Down below, you will see a permanent link to the Storm Clan Discord. Strongly encourage you to take a look. We also have links to the dev blog on submarines. Since we mentioned King of the Seas, I'll try to get a link in there to the King of the Seas server. Hey, Newfie, are you guys going to make a run at King of the Seas this year?
Maybe.
It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. There are clans I don't mean to be elitist here, but there's clans in there that you would probably have some good matches against, you know?
I would agree. Our trouble is commitment.
Yeah.
That's it. like the number of, yeah, the amount of time required to get for people, right, to get in there.
Well, maybe COVID conditions will help you.
Want to.
Yeah, we certainly. I hope we see you there.
I've heard that used in the good, combined with that word, but I'll take it for what it is.
Yep. Well, also below is Boggzy's Twitch stream. Please like, follow and subscribe.
Follow.
And ooh, consider subscribing. Too. Yep.
Would you?
Aw. Yeah.
Aw.
Yeah.
Just so nice.
We should maybe we should have a like an admission fee for being a guest. So you have to subscribe to Boggzy's. but also on that note, I do want to get our follower count up on YouTube, because I want to get the special reward they're going to send us when he hits 25 subscribers. So yada, yada, yada. Y'all know the spiel. Oh, and of course, and as always, the North American Clan Embassy. Be there or be square, my friend. Boggzy, take us home.
Great. Well, this has been a delightful episode. Thank you very much, Newfie of Storm Clan, for joining us and for sharing with us some of your delightful Canadian tomfoolery. I guess with that, thank you all very much for continuing to tune in. Thank you all very much for continuing to